You ready?
Yes.
So thank you for coming.
to this presentation. It's pretty much a very formal introduction of things that I have been doing throughout these last 2 years, and kind of some tips that I learned through the way. And I'll start with a roadmap. Here, how we started the last 2 years in online teaching. It started in the spring 2015. I got here to UNM in the fall 2014, and we had some issues with the online language teaching here in the SSL program, and that's where, kind of by me, I was motivated to dig a little bit more into this. So everything started in the spring 2015. As I said, in 101 and 102, these are the only courses that we had at that time available for online language teaching in the SSL program. Since then, we added a new format. We used to have 16 weeks, like a regular 16 weeks course, and now we have the 2-8. This 2-8 is second half. It's intensive 8-week course. We have a new textbook and a new online platform in Conectados and iLearn. And iLearn is working really well for us in online teaching because it has a very friendly, intuitive layout itself, where it starts with, let's start here, then practice, use it, test it, and then at the end is the got it. And got it is a self-testing process. So it's working really well for us. Then in extended learning here at UNM, they make it mandatory now for whoever is coordinating TAs that we have to go through a specific training as faculty members. The coordinators will have to go to this training, a workshop on best practices of online teaching at UNM. And these, it was very intense, to be honest, just to be in that workshop. Lots of work, but there is a lot of things that you take from your own courses. After that, and that was a requirement for me to continue with certification, after that we went through an internal review for best practices of online teaching. That's how they call it, best practices in online teaching at UNM. And this review, the internal review in UNM, is actually directly aligned with national certification for online courses. Portuguese 101 is meeting these requirements. So whatever I'm presenting you today here, Portuguese 101 online, it's already very advanced on its own. So when we're ready in Portuguese, we'll be able to get the national certification. MOPS, this is a management online program. We offer, starting in summer 2017, we offer 202 online for these management online programs. These are programs like Chicana Studies, Psychology, that they offer entire degrees online, and they require 202 or 212 as a requirement. So 276, it could be, in Portuguese, it could be a course that could be ready for this, or 277 too. And the last step in all of this roadmap is the National Quality Matters Certification, and we actually received it on Tuesday for 102, and it's coming in 101, so it's very, very nice. So this is what it looks like when you have the internal best practices at UNM. They put a paw, like the logo, the both, like best practices. So this is what it says when you meet those best practices at UNM. In Portuguese 101, the course with Andre is about to receive that. Yes. And it's an indicator of you meet all these requirements. And it's already, it's a very thorough review, and Andre Nascimento is going through that. And Marina, I think, too, in 301. It's a little different process for a graduate teaching assistant and a faculty member. I'll explain to you in a little bit. So the quality matters, like what is it? And pretty much this is like ACFL, TOEFL. Quality Matters is the agency that will give you the national accreditation in the United States. and you see the higher ed, that's what HE stands for, you see the logo there and the requirements that they actually check to make sure that you have all of them. You have to meet all the requirements in the online courses. And I'm going to go through this in a minute. So just to give you a snapshot of what is an UNM. UNM, online learner, is motivated. They get into these courses by access. It's very easy. I don't have to be on campus. By personality, a specific personality. You have to have a specific profile of a student for this, and achievement. Some of them, some of those students, they are taking classes in high school. Many of them, they are in AIMS. I don't know if you're familiar with charter school here, the science and technology one, that they take a lot of AP courses or dual college credit, so they're already in our classes. So our classes, language classes, have a mixture of high achievers, the dual college credit students, and kind of not motivated for language requirement, lazy. That's the truth. That's the, you get this, the whole spectrum. And you have a mix of high achievers that will ask you for a lot of information. They want to perform really well. They want to be exposed to quality and a lot of communication from you. And then the other ones, always constantly asking for, how do I do this? How do I do that? I didn't know that. How do you transfer my video on the phone from the computer? Things like that. So you have the two opposites. Here at UNM, the proficiency in those courses is not determined by placement yet. So pretty much they can get into any course they want. We try to filter them by accessing the roster and asking them a kind of a questionnaire of who are you, have you taken classes before, especially one-on-one. And there's a different degrees of knowledge of expectations of technology. Like we expect, the teachers, we expect that they should be familiar with lots of technology. And we have this misperception that they are in social media and they are savvy about technology, but the reality is no, they're not. The online language teacher here at UNM, there's a learning curve. There's a big difference between being an online language teacher, the graduate teaching system one, and faculty in terms of support. Extended learning offers pretty much 100% support for people who have low key or low profiles on technology. If you're a faculty member, you receive a lot of support. If you're a graduate teaching assistant, you receive some guidance. And kind of, in my case, we'll be kind of in the middle. I'm a faculty member, but I'm certifying TA courses taught by TAs. So it's a little bit different. They're motivated, the teachers, by access too. It's, you don't have to come to campus to teach. You can do it. It's the same as the student. Independent, sometimes for research purposes. You have professors that they can be in another country, but they can teach online. So that's an incentive for them or a motivation. And maybe other, I don't know. I actually don't know that much about this. But there is a big difference between the 100 and 200 online instruction here at UNM in language with versus the 300 and 400 in terms of expectations and engagement within UNM Learn. So I'll give you kind of a summary of what normally is the layout of a 300 and 400 level course, language course here. The professor, professor, teacher, instructor posts readings, and then you discuss them, maybe discussion board, and that's it. It's, you have a reading, and then you have a discussion board, maybe. Or you have a writing assignment. You have an essay that you have to post. And it's very, very different from, and you will see that, from the 100 and 200 level courses. So the first question you have to ask is this actually for you or not? Because not everyone feels comfortable and ready for this. Or maybe you don't believe in online language teaching. It requires a lot of constant communication, and by constant is constant. Within the hour, lots of emails populating in your your inbox. Familiarity and high degree of comfort in digital literacy, you have to know way much more than the students. You have to know how to help them when they are having some issues. With the instructor is expected to know, are you familiar with Blackboard? Not UNMLearn. UNMLearn is Blackboard. But are you familiar with Blackboard? Do you know how to set up wikis, journals, pair chats, conference calls, Kaltura videos, capsule videos? You have to be a detail-oriented instructor. You have to have strong organizational skills. And so all the characteristics, and it's not more, lots of patience regarding how to, or the logistics for collaborative activities. So you will see that in a minute. For paid chat activities, for conference call activities, I cannot log in. My paid chat starts in 5 minutes. Help me. Well, go to the support. Nobody's going to help you within a time frame of 5 minutes. But that's kind of the questions that you have. So before you write, with the patients. So where do you begin, or where do we begin? So there is a difference between that spontaneity and immediate accommodation, all the changes that you can do in a face-to-face language classroom, that you can do it and you can perceive things, you can see if students are falling asleep, you can see if they're not paying attention, you can see if you have to make an intervention based on use of cell phone. You don't have it on the online platform. The online course syllabus is not a direct transfer of the face-to-face syllabus. And this is something that it's kind of the first learning moment. The online course syllabi is not direct transferring from the face-to-face. You have to measure participation in a different way. You don't have classroom participation. Do you measure participation by getting in on UNMLearn? Just getting in, and how many seconds do they last getting in UNMLearn? Do you measure participation? Do you give grades for this? If you have a grade on this, you have to have rubrics for it. And normally in our classes, in face-to-face classroom, we don't have this issue. You know who's participating or not, but not in the online. You have to have rubrics for participation based on completion, like they do the activities. Otherwise, you will be very overwhelmed with grading every single pair chat, for instance, conversations that are happening. And the reality is that in face-to-face language classrooms, we don't actually check groups to see how everyone is interacting. We go through the room and we check and make sure that they are following and they're doing the activities that we're supposed to. So we cannot be more picky or very strict on the online platform, because actually you will see that they will participate much more, and you will see that in a minute. And feedback, apart in addition to the rubrics, you have to give feedback. Sometimes in the face-to-face classroom, we give the feedback right away, or just on your way outside of the class. But in online language settings, you have to have that feedback in writing or in speaking. So I'm going to give you like a series of tips. And the tips are based on the Quality Matters review rubric that they go through with you, in this case with me, on the telephone, on the two telephone interviews and the exams. So the tip number one is online language course syllabi. They're going to look at your syllabi. So the same student learning outcomes, you have to have the same ones from the face-to-face. So this is something that it cannot be changed. You have to have a clear statement of participation online. What do you mean by participation online? Access to the platform and duration of the student in the platform is participation measured by UNMLearn activities, and that's what we do in Spanish 101 and 102. We require them to do a lot of UNMLearn activities, and that's the way we know that they're participating. In Portuguese 101 is the same. And expectations, like I expect, like these are expectations in the class. Who is a student in an online language class that is meeting expectations? Somebody who does the pair chats, somebody who normally participates in the journals, you are present on the videos, you attend the conference call, and they go by completion. You've done it? Yes. It's 0 or 100. Otherwise, the teacher will be overwhelmed to grade all of these activities. direct and varied formats to address writing and speaking based on language skills and modes of communication. So you have to have a mix of interpersonal speaking, interpersonal writing, presentational speaking, presentational writing activities, reading is interpreted, and listening is interpreted too. A syllabus constant format, this is very, very, very important. You have to have a requirement that they read the syllabus and they agree with the statements on the syllabus. And I'll show you how we got very good accolades from the National Board from what we're doing recently for 102 and the deepest council. And the statement of dropping and a W. It is very, very important that you have a clear statement of when and how you're going to drop students based on X. So if you say, if you have not been participating in UNM Learn, like I don't have anything from you in UNM Learn for a period of how many weeks, then I drop you from the course. We highly recommend to do this to instructors. Why? Because online courses, they are highly demanded, but the quality may not be correlated with the demand. So we're actually trying to filter students by we're giving the spots to the students who really deserve to be there. So we are a little bit strict, actually, to be honest, in the online classes with the dropping and the W. It has an intense flipped interactive classroom. It cannot be a lecture that you record a lecture and then you have it there and then you ask for an essay or for a discussion board where you ask them to have a common thread. You have to have a higher degree of interaction. The tip number two is the layout. And I can show you, if you want, at the end, kind of what it looks like, the one that got certified recently, so that you can have a look at this. The left menu, this is where you have the options of course information, grades. It has to be very easy to click and consistent use of those labels. So if you have a label that says discussion, that discussion, the word discussion has to be used throughout your course on your modules as discussion. In our case, in the Spanish 101 or 102, hablar en español, there are paired chats that require speaking. So hablar en español, they know it's paired chats. And discussions are interpersonal writing. So they are writing, but they are exchanging information. Our presentational writing activities are journals. Where, why and where, you wanna do that whenever you don't want the whole collaborative learning activity. You want the student to actually write to you as an instructor, and you're the only one who sees that and who provides feedback. But you have to have both, that's very important. You have to have the intro course, the contact info. Everybody, I think this is very easy. The course syllabus, the policies, and the structure. And I'll tell you what I mean in a minute by adaptive release. Adaptive release, what it means is you have a moment after that overview intro module that you have, you insert the consent form for the syllabus right there before you start with the first chapter, for instance. And it's adaptive, and what it means is you cannot access the first module, the first chapter of the course, unless you complete the syllabus. And the syllabus is a survey, and you cannot receive participation grade until the survey, what it says is this: I have read the syllabus, click. I understand the policies, click. I accept the policies, click. And that's when it allows you to open first chapter. So that's something, that's the one that I told you that we received good accolades for this, because it's a required and it's blocked. If they don't do it, they have to actually go back. And it's not open until you have they have read it, they understand it, so they can always ask questions, and then they agree. Then the other one is, you have a start here orientation to the course module. You have modules divided by weeks. Week one, week two, module one, module two. Then consistent deadlines once or twice a week. And this is very, very important. Instead of saying you have deadlines every day, at the national level, they want everyone to have like one only deadline that is consistent. So in our case, it will be Mondays at 11:59 p.m. because all nine language learners, most of them have full-time jobs, so they actually, the peak hours for them to study are weekends and in the night. So Mondays, everything is due the next Monday, but the modules for the next week, they open for high achievers Fridays or Mondays at 8 a.m. So the ones that are late, they procrastinate, they're working on Monday, late evening. But the ones that are, they want to work ahead, they have the module activated earlier. So this is what I meant by the OAK is the temporary spring 2017. This is what I had to produce for the national review. So you see the labels. So it says announcements, discussions, my journals. And but you have to use my journals throughout course syllabi and throughout your modules so that everybody understands like what do you mean by that. And that's the place where you would submit all of them. And the course map, this is something that it was also very nicely recognized by the reviewers. You have the SLOs, the student learning outcomes that you wanna, you have it in your course. And my advice is keep it low, meaning don't have like 8 or 9, otherwise it's gonna be very difficult to measure. And then you have all the activities and assignments in the course that meet each of those student learning outcomes. And that's the course map. And that's what is something that you have to have it in your display. Then we have another one, which is the tip number 3, the course overview and introduction. So they expect an introduction from you, and it's a video. It has to be a video. Videos in language learning in online, they have to be no longer than 4 minutes. So 2-3 minutes, it meets the requirements. An intro student too. You have to ask for an introductory task so that everybody meets each other. Why? Because in these classes, we ask them to put together in groups of 2 for pair chats, so they need to actually see who's gonna be a potential partner. It can be done through discussion boards so that everybody can see it. It can be through a blog, it can be through a wiki, a collaborative writing, so a class. So you edit the wiki and Desi will put her introduction. Then Mark edit the wiki and Mark will put the introduction. And then at the end you have all, like the entire roster of students already introduced themselves. And that's what they check. They check that there is an introductory message by a video from the instructor and a student as well. Offered to meet with the instructor and if you're in UNM Learn, we have here in UNM, we have a lot of students who are taking classes, but they are in UNM, so sometimes they meet face to face with the instructor. But since sometimes we have students from other places, other states, you have to at least offer some time to meet with them through conference call, or through collaborate in this case. Instructional elements, each module should have an overview page, and I'll show it to you. You have to have a summary of all the wiki activities and relationship to the student learning outcomes of the course. And in our case, we go a little bit the extra mile identifying what kind of modes of communication and what kind of language skills they're practicing. So that everybody's on board saying, knowing that they're practicing speaking, they're practicing writing, they're practicing interpersonal writing and speaking, or interpersonal writing too. You have to have a list of to-do activities. This is what they're expected, and in a list, like this, so that high achievers or organized learners or even the lazy ones. Like this is what I need to accomplish. I have to have this from Ireland, from my Portuguese lab, this exercise, and a person who meets the expectation for participation will be a person that has checked all the activities. You have to activate all the assignments are due X X within the module. So you don't put things outside of the module, inside of the module, everything has to be consistent so that they know where to upload things. That's how you can see like the overview, week two, and that's, I'll show it to you at the end. And then you have find a pair chat, that's one of the activities. You have to find your pair. Then another one, hablar en español, that's already the activity itself. And you have the instructions on how to do it. One very important lesson for me, that it took me a lot of time to fix this, was at the very beginning, when we started in 2015, and it was with Sam Johnson, former grad student here, we put a lot of color and highlighted all the information. For national accreditation for the Association of Disability Act for blind people, we're not supposed to have it. So, for the review, 16 modules, click on every single activity and deleting all the color, so bold. Bold is what we are suggested to do. Cursive is a little bit difficult, and underline, so bold is kind of the summary. And this was a learning experience for me. I didn't know that we were out of compliance with these things. It doesn't happen frequently, but for national accreditation purposes, you have to have it. The other one, the interaction and collaboration. And this is where it differs a little bit from the 300, 400 level courses, or even 500, whoever teaches them, and the 100 and 200. We require a lot of collaborative activities, a lot of them, and we measure them with participation rubrics. So they have to have interpersonal speaking. They have to be speaking in the pair chats. They have to have, in the chatting, you can, it's like a Skype. You can talk in the Skype with the videos, but you can also chat in writing. So that's already activities for interpersonal speaking, interpersonal writing. For presentational writing, this is where you as an instructor, you provide individual feedback to one person. So that's the journal. The journal is private. You open a journal, this is the prompt in English, not in the target language, and you ask them to do something. And you provide feedback to the people. And you are the only one who sees this. The other ones are discussion boards or blogs where you see a student making comments about each other. The presentation speaking, these are the Cultura media, the videos, where they upload a video. And sometimes we require them to check somebody else's video and make a comment in the Spanish or Portuguese about that video. So most of the times we do an introduction. Like we require them to post your introduction in the Spanish or Portuguese, and then you have to actually see somebody else and make a comment about, oh, I didn't know that you were from Texas. I'm from Texas too. Something like that, but in the target language. The next one, the assessment and feedback. You have to have lots of rubrics for tests and academic integrity too. Academic integrity in the testing, you have to have a display in the test at the very beginning, before they click start with the test, that says no online translators, kind of the academic integrity principles in foreign language learning, and a reference to the syllabus, so that everybody's on board. And nobody will tell you, I didn't know that I couldn't do it. You took the signed consent form, that you read the syllabus, you read it, you understood it, and you agreed. And before you start, you have that reference of academic integrity. You have rubrics for participation. Like, what does it mean, participation? You complete the task. Like, our instructors are not required to check every single pair chat that happens every week and listen to it and provide feedback. We go by a holistic approach where you click on the video, you see that they're speaking in Spanish or Portuguese. Okay, you complete it, 100. But that's participation. And they have, in these courses, they have 16 pair chats and 16 discussion boards. So you have a lot. Actually, once you teach online this way, you realize that you know the participation is higher and is expected more of you if you are in online language teaching instead of in the face-to-face. In the face-to-face, It's based on do I get to hear you speaking or not. In the online language classrooms, they actually participate way much more. I highlighted that for you, feedback. And that's something that we were missing for the national certification. So the first conference call was an interview, and they saw very rich rubrics, but they didn't see the feedback. So something about, they were expecting something about this. I'm glad I'm seeing your growth. Like, I'm glad that you went through this to this place. I can see that you're speaking a little bit in English in your paid chats. Try not to do it. So what we did was to provide a list of options. Like, I think there are like 10 options for feedback, and instructors, they select the ones that apply. Like, great, you do great. Great, but this, and you need to start doing this. Like, there are three different kinds of feedback, and that's something that we didn't have before. In all these activities, the journal, the pair chats, and the conference call. And the other one was a mid-course instructor video. That's another one that we received accolades based on being unique about doing this. And that's something that we started Sam Johnson and myself doing in the spring 2015, in the middle of the semester. And you can see 16 weeks, right after 8 week and before the 9th week. You post a video and in English, it's not in the target language. And before that video, all you have to do is kind of go through the iLearn or my Portuguese Lab platform and see kind of what are the trends that you're seeing as trends. They're writing really well in this. They're speaking a lot in the target language. As trends of mistakes or errors that you see, trends, like class trends. And the other one, it will be areas for improvement. And encouragement that they are in the middle of the semester, that they should be more active, maybe, on iLearn. Or I encourage you all to do the self-assessments at the very end of each chapter, because it helps you. This was very, very effective, and we received a lot of comments, positive comments, in the evaluations the first semester when we implemented Sam Johnson and myself. He was doing one class, I was piloting another one. So both of us, just because of doing this, we didn't identify anybody. Like, we were not saying, Angelica, great job for this. We were saying, this is what we're seeing, we're noticing. So maybe, I don't know, for higher level courses will be, you're not reading for, I'm not noticing. Like, I'm not noticing that you're not reading in detail. This is not about reading, it's about scheming through or paying attention to these details. Something like this. So that happens in the mid-semester. The number seven is course evaluation. One of the things that we did as well was to have an indirect measurement of assessment, and that's something that coordinators will have to document it to, which is, it's a student reflection of what they have learned in the class. So normally in other states and other universities, and that's kind of a comment that I received in my own evaluation for our courses at UNM, what they have is an assignment, a discussion board or a journal that says, could you have a reflection of what you have learned in the class? But you're already prompting the students that they have learned something. And it's very generic. What we did for our purposes was to create a can-do statement survey. And that can-do statement survey is the same student learning outcomes that you're measuring from the very beginning. Like, you expected students to do this. So the survey asks, do you think that now you can do this? And that's it. That's what it is. And it's quantifiable here on the records. So whoever does assessment, you already have the records recorded. And it's safe. The data is stored there. So that was another area that they saw that it was unique for us. And these are just tips for consideration. And if you allow me, I'll show you a little bit. I click
on things. But I hope I went all the way. Okay, I just wanted something to show you something.
So this is where they post in UNM, and in, sorry, in UNM, in the website. When you have the logo, the QM, you see the little red one, the quality matters, that means that it has been accredited. Ours is coming in 101 and 102. 102 is coming this week. This week it should be already. I don't think it's there. But in 101, I have the test next week. So if you see not many people, they have the QM, the national. All the people who have been identified here, we meet the UNM internal best practices, but not the national ones. So in our case, you see the ones at the very end, they are the team and master course for 101 or 102. We are the last ones, so this is very, very recent. Very, very recent, meaning we met those, I think, in the summer, and the QM for 102 was approved this Tuesday. So I hope you enjoy it. For me, this was a lot of work, a lot of work. So if I show it to you, it's not to brag at all. This is for TAs. This is not for me. This is not my graduate courses. It's certification for TA courses. And kind of the take-home message for me is, when you go out for the job market, you can actually tell that you need the quality matters, the national certification for job purposes. The other one is this. I can click in anything you want me to, but I will show you how it looks. They start here, then this is the book, these are the modules, and pretty much the snapshots that I took, the screenshots, they were from here. We have rubrics, we have activities, I can click as much as you want. One of the comments that I received from the national reviewers were that they have not seen such a populated and rigorous language course at all. So, it's like, good work. I think, it's like, yeah, that's what he meant. So, in a very humble way, I actually tell you, I'm just giving you tips that have worked to achieve national recognition. So, just for your consideration, whoever teaches now 101 or 102, you have to actually do all of this because we are now maintaining the status quo. This is something that it will be reviewed. I think it's like every 2 years they give you a follow-up to see if you're still maintaining the status. It's not that bad to maintain your own courses. Like, you are the instructor, but when you have different TAs, you come and go. Elena knows this. You have this TA and then goes. Then you have to train this other one, goes. So you don't have permanency on this. So it's very, very challenging to actually do this and be able to maintain the rigor. So that's why I was hoping here, whoever, it's a call for whoever is interested in this. If this is for you, you have all the end, all the requirements. If this is for you, let me know. And we're always looking for new people who want to teach online. Why? Because people come and go. So it's kind of a challenge for us just to keep the same people online all the time because they leave. So we have to train people. And for SSL, at least for SSL, all the summer courses are taught online and you don't have a coordinator. Like, we don't get salaries to coordinate in the summer. So you are by yourself. By yourself with that rigorous course, you get a lot of complaints. The very recent email that we got is actually, and I didn't know that Andres and Leila will be here. But this morning, Andre received an email from one of his new students. So this is a very good news for Portuguese. Portuguese 101 started this Monday. It's an eight week accelerated. It has waiting lists, which is, wow, that is very nice. But he received today, this morning, an email from a student saying, I really like the professional outlook of this course. Everything is organized neat. He received a very nice comment about, wow, this is a very organized class. I think this speaks volumes of what the students are seeing. It gives visibility and it gives rigor to our programs. So that's it. So whatever you want to ask me or comment, feel free to do so.
I just to mention, I also got like some comments on the organization of the course online in the summer. Like the students liked it a lot, so, and the participation thing. So
that's good. That's good. Okay. Yes.
So you were saying that the students can access the the modules, the chapters,
yes,
until they read the syllabus. Is that, so is the book integrated? Because that is some of the problems we had with Portuguese, because you had to combine learn and then
So UNM for FERPA does not allow any tutorial yet.
Any
tutorial,
okay.
Any. Like Pearson, Cengage, no one is authorized in UNM to integrate. So they have to do, I can show it to you. I think I can answer this question if I show it to you. Okay, yes. So you see, that would be Ponto de Encontro. That would be my Portuguese lab.
Uh-huh.
They have to actually go outside.
Yeah,
they have to click
because
it's not integrated.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the other activities that they're supposed to do that they have to fulfill the contract.
Oh, for this, it's for the syllabus.
Okay, so before, no, but they read the syllabus and then they say, I understand this, I agree with this.
Yes.
But then that allows them to access what materials? The additional materials of the book?
The entire course.
All of it.
So,
so there is an integration.
You have the, just the contact information, then the course map, and all of a sudden, you cannot start the course, any material, nothing. Until you,
but not even the book.
The book is not there.
The book you will see it here. Here.
So it's different. Okay,
yeah.
So they can access the book, but not the other
books.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. And it's just a matter of you have to stop. You have to read a syllabus.
Mm-hmm.
Even in face-to-face language classrooms, we don't have this.
Mm-hmm.
We give
the
syllabus.
Mm-hmm.
No,
we do.
Some of us do.
In those kind of contracts. The TH, you know, in SSL, in Portuguese, we tell them, keep this till the end of the semester. Because then you say, you have signed this.
Mm-hmm.
In online, that part where it does not allow you to continue, it's actually very important.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very, very important, especially for academic integrity too.
Yeah.
They will understand. They will understand very clearly that you have expectations for them. And we increase the rigor a lot. People administration is getting onto these courses. They're commending like the amount of the rigor, especially the rigor. Why? Because there is that misperception that online language, like online teaching is easy. Like it's, you're gonna get an A. No, no. So online, Spanish 101, 102, Portuguese 101, are they populated? Yes, but it's not because they're busy. And it's not. Otherwise, they will leave the course immediately. We are actually dropping them. And we are dropping them because we want to help the other moments,
mm-hmm.
which is the face-to-face classrooms. So that's kind of what people see as they, oh, they're online, it's just because it's easy. No, it's not. No, it's not. Actually, I think that this is more difficult.
Mm-hmm.
Like when they do this, all of this in these courses, it's actually more and more difficult. And the students are staying. They're not dropping. They're not dropping it. Some of them they're motivated by the need that they have to actually take these courses. But even though they need it and they may not be motivated, Desi left. But the summer people normally are the ones that meet the foreign language requirement. I don't want to deal with this course. We're actually seeing that the summer online people they continue. In 102, which is something that we were not expecting it at all. I'm not saying that 101, like online teaching, is the way to go for everything. I think it has a lot of potential for study abroad, mixing study abroad with online. You can be studying abroad while doing a very rigorous course online and get rid of those issues of access, and you are already there abroad. So I think study abroad, like kind of the immersion with these rigorous online courses, I think is good. Angelica, and I'm trying to think right now, you weren't Portuguese.
Yeah.
You learned the Portuguese one online, right?
Uh-huh.
And can you share your experience? Because I know your experience is the one that you may prefer face to face.
Yeah.
Yes.
It was too hard, and I dropped it because, or I talked to Andre about dropping it, and he's like, "Well, you have a C right now, so we'll just give you the C." And I'm like, "That's fine with me," but it was too hard. I was like, I'd rather go, personally, it's just my personal choice, so I'd rather go to a class and have that interaction in the class environment than online. It was hard to just sit there and be like, okay, let me talk into the microphone to some stranger I don't even know. And it was, for my personality, it was really uncomfortable, and I didn't like it. But, and then again, I was going to Spain and Portugal that summer, so I was like, just give me some real quick, like, you know, introduce me to Portuguese real quick, so that way I'm not completely lost in Portugal, and it was, I would rather than in the class. But it was hard. As a graduate student taking a 101 class, I was like, no, it's too hard.
Yeah. But that on its own, that comment speaks volumes of, at least with the objectives for us, for the other side of the spectrum, is just get rid of that stereotype, of that misconception that you cannot teach an online language course online. Like, you can't. Yes, you can. It's not easy, and it may be even harder. And it is. But I think you have to have that kind of motivation, inner motivation to do it. So not everybody, that's what I put at the very beginning. This is not for everybody. Not every teacher will jump into this either. You have to have. I remember that is in 2015, and I'll share this with you. My professors that, you know, the really, that those platforms, they only had first, not bad comment, but kind of negative comment that I received. It's there from that course online. And I'll tell you why. It says at the very beginning. At the very beginning, she was very nice and responded all the messages, but then she became lazy. Lazy, that was the word. Lazy. And I found out why. So I got upset about that comment. Like, I do not deserve this. Like, lazy is not an adjective that will describe me at all. And I know it, and I can prove it. So I said, but why? Like, why did I get that comment? And Sam was the one who allowed me to kind of click on my own. Sam said, Eva, I actually got the same comment. So let's think about this. So okay, so we sat together. He said, how many times do you actually check? You actually respond emails, like daily, tons. I remember weekends helping students. And he said, okay, this is the same with him. Do you actually respond one-on-one? Yes, to every single email. Okay, so that maybe that was the problem. And that was the problem. I never addressed the entire class with all these questions. I always responded to individual questions. But I never did that kind of overall answer to the entire class. So the class didn't see that I was there. But I was, and Sam was the same. So we changed it fall 2015 semester, and it worked really well. Why? Because whenever we were getting like two questions about the same thing, we immediately posted an announcement. And we immediately wrote an email, and that's it. And we waited for accumulation of emails, and then we wrote a message. So that was kind of the learning path for this. As a coordinator and as a faculty member, I can tell you that the course evaluations in online language teaching, they're a little bit lower, the results, but it's just because of the rigor. And so whoever's reading those course evaluations and letters of recommendations, we always address that if you're an online language teacher, it is suspected that your course evaluations may be a little bit lower, and your qualitative comments, they may be a little bit more strict, they would expect more just because they have challenges with technology, for instance. But that's not a problem of the instructor, or just because it's very hard. Like, it's hard. Hard, what does that mean? Is that a bad comment or a good comment? It may not be a bad comment. Like, this class is hard, or this instructor is challenging. Is this a good comment or a bad comment? It depends. It depends. It shouldn't be a bad comment at all. A rating from 1 to 5, if you have ratings of 5, you may be well on the easy grading instructor side. So kind of the best would be 3s, some 4s, maybe 1.5 or 2.5, but not having everything is 5. If you have like everything is like a 2, then there's something going on with that teacher. But if you have like the zigzag effect that I told you many times, that's the expected, you have this, that means that you're the same teacher and you're getting the same. That's how we measure your rigor, which is not bad. Being rigorous is not bad at all. It's completely opposite. But we all have to have that balance, that you can be very rigorous, but you can be very approachable, you can be very helpful, you can be positive and encouraging the students, and that's where the fairness comes into play. You can expect a lot, but you give a lot, and you help a lot. So that's the kind of the medium where it would be. So, more comments, more questions?
This is the professional way it's going.
The what?
A profession. When yes. People is outside the UNM factor, when you're outside of academics,
yes.
Everybody that is involved with business, politics, government, and any other thing that is interacting internationally, their education for languages and international relations is in this type of platforms. So exposing the students now and at the end of with a career is beneficial for all of them. So it's giving them a leg up when they get out in the real world. So it's really good.
And Anna, not many people may know you. Anna is our PhD student and she's in Hispanic linguistics. But she is the coordinator of Spanish and Portuguese in the Air Force here in UNM. So she has been coordinating the punto de control. She has been a coordinator. So she's kind of, this comment is from a person that knows that it's not from the academia perspective, but it's in the profession inside of a platform that is not academia.
And all my training in Portuguese is this way. I have really gone to like, we're going to a fourth contract right now with a different company, a different platform. And every time we have to learn, and they're not Blackboard. Many people think out there that the only way to teach in online, you use Blackboard. It is not true.
Okay.
Office has it, many other companies have it, and sometimes I'm in 2 classes at the same time and I'm learning 2 different platforms because that's what it is out there. So, but what I'm saying is this is really good for the students. And it is true. I have seen many students that are not capable, like you mentioned, of not being with the professor in front mm-hmm. of them and constant interaction while the learning is occurring, and they cannot keep up with the classes. And it's nothing about the student not being able to comprehend the material. It is that's not their learning way.
Mm-hmm.
And it's good. It works for some people, it doesn't work for all, but having it here as an undergrad and then moving into the graduate courses, it is helping the student population and the workforce.
One of the other things I didn't mention, and thank you, Anna, for saying this, is the professional etiquette in online or in face-to-face. Students, when they complain, like, my partner didn't come. I cannot achieve my goal, like a group assignment. I cannot do this. And they gossip with the instructor about this, like, my partner didn't do this. So what is my grade? I'm gonna get an A. Real world scenario is you have a deadline, you are working on a group, you may not like your peer, but you have to submit something.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to talk to somebody. And you have to talk in front of people. Even though you have anxiety issues talking in front of people. If that's the case, you really need to, that student really needs to address these issues very soon. Why? Every single work scenario, it it requires some presentation, presentational speaking, interpersonal speaking. So that professional etiquette, sometimes we don't expect it in the classroom face-to-face and we mock things, but in the online language teaching, you have the professional etiquette that is called netiquette. Netiquette by respect others. Say something positive, say something that's not that positive, but you have to learn how to behave professionally. And professionally means compromise, commitment. And we're seeing that in the 202, the summer class, this is something that Sarah Pisani taught. She already met the internal best practices for UNM. And some of the students, they were actually making comments about that. That the courses, the course, the 202, allowed them to think about carefully about how to say things, how to present things, what to say, what not to say, how you interact in a way that is culturally appropriate. That's something that we work a lot, especially with 202. Where do you draw the line between, I'll say your personality, being direct. Like Spaniards, we have that stereotype that we're very, very direct. Well, that's a cultural appropriate environment for whoever is in academia in Spain. You have to be direct because professors ask you and expect you to be direct. But it may not be in another context or scenario, and you may overwhelm other people. And that's kind of the learning, the professional etiquette of intercultural competence. And I know Andresa has a very good project.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to putting these on this online platform.
That's good. That's really nice.
And I have a quick question about Talk Abroad, because I am using Talk Abroad with my students, and I would like to know if is there any online course that is also using Talk Abroad?
Okay, and Leslie, you can. I don't know if you're familiar with this conversation. That is a conversation that we already started with Pam Castaldi. Talk Abroad will require a course fee.
Yeah.
And for online language teaching, the online language, the credit course, the tuition for online is more expensive.
Oh, okay.
It's higher. And the TAs, the instructors, they get a little bit more money for teaching online. But if we insert Talk Abroad, since it's a third outside provider, we'll have to increase that course fee.
Oh, okay.
So we're looking into ways with the CAPS tutoring to have tutors for online tutoring, but they will be in UNM.
Mm-hmm.
Like online tutors at CAPS here at UNM, native speakers of Portuguese in this case, that would actually do the conversations.
Yeah, from what I'm getting from my students now, from their experience with Talk Abroad, in the beginning they were very scared about the idea of talking 20 minutes with someone, but now they are loving the experience. They are really enjoying it, and now some of them are asking if they can do more, and if they can, how they can use these resources even more in the classes.
So Pam Castaldi, I mean the Language Learning Lab, it absorbing the cost of the Talk Abroad. We currently use Talk Abroad in 201, all 201, 202, 276.
Yeah. Yeah, 276 I think is the only one now for Portuguese.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I was going to start it, but
I think we require 3 or 4 conversations. And it's working really well. Leslie is working really, really well. And that's why it was, Pam was a little bit overwhelmed this semester because we added the 202, because students are asking for it. So we're actually looking into have online tutoring, the online Talk Abroad internally here at UNM, but through CAPS. So the tutors will be here, the native speakers will be here in UNM. But it will have these Skype conversations or conference call conversations with our students. Why? Because everything needs to remain online, even though we work here. So thank you for saying that. And that's another compliment for Talk Abroad. It is, it's working really, really well, but it's not free. So that's why it's a chance for the online. Okay, thank you.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you.